Hey, you out there. You want some culturally concise commentary? You want some co-hosts who actually are authentic and real? And you can tell that they actually have some type of chemistry going on?
Hey, cloud chasing. That's cool. I actually got something in mind for you. So keep listening.
Hopefully it works. Last time we did this.
You'll find out.
This is Touchdowns and Tangents, your weekly spot for NFL takes, culturally concise, tangent, and context for the culture.
Test. Hopefully it's working. What's up, good people? Live from Touchdowns and Tangents, Cuss
Incorporated, the TDT Cave.
It's a dynamic duo, your spot for NFL takes, topical tangents, concise commentary for the culture. I'm Pete D. Camarillo.
I'm Kenneth, not an NPC, Barry.
And then we have the GOAT producer, Nikki. Howdy. She whipped my ass in fantasy this week.
I'm whooping her ass in fantasy right now, so it's all good. She was like, see, this is why I didn't want
to
show.
See, Jalen Hurts has like 14 yards. It's just that he decided to rush in like three touchdowns.
Hey, man.
On the goal line, so
don't get mad at a QB.
I have him in my other ESPN league.
Yes, I have Jake Elliott in my other league, but I'm blowing them out, so it doesn't matter.
But that's why
our Eagles defense.
That's why I learned last year to stack Jalen with someone.
Yeah.
It's better when you stack him with Devontae or AJ.
Yeah.
Good.
Dallas Goedert did something. I'm just happy Dallas Goedert did something. Because 0 points last week was wild. Goedert? However you say his last name. Yeah.
Cool. Thank you. All right. So we're live.
Yeah.
Yeah, man. I didn't really watch much else on the Thursday night football other than just my fantasy ticker.
Vikings.
The one good thing we could ever count on Lucas for, Thursday night report.
They came back. I mean,
hey, I don't know. I'd be watching Thursday night football. I don't know why y'all don't.
All I do is watch football, like all day at work. So I'm like all day.
When you love it, it's not really a job.
Oh God! Here we go.
That sounds like gaslighting into severe abuse and trauma.
I don't know. Why don't we watch Thursday night? It's like we're always busy. Like we're always like either mentally or like physically preparing for this shit. Like
yeah, Thursdays are my holy sanctum. Where like I just need to shut everything out. Like, and I got off work at 6 a.m.
Plus, Amazon Prime sucks, so don't blame me.
Really?
I have Amazon Prime.
I like it. I feel like they've done innovative stuff.
I watch for the shows.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
I don't watch that's for true. Broadcasting of football games. I could care less.
I'm pretty sure last week or last year's Thursday night football schedule had to have been like the worst lineup of games like, ever.
I mean, this one allegedly isn't too far off.
This one was at least halfway interesting because, yeah, it was a blowout, but at least there was a good team on the screen at some point.
Tis true.
Which is, you know, rare for Amazon Prime, so good for them.
Yeah, and I mean, Eagles-Vikings, just a good matchup.
See, I feel like that was, like, one of the better matchups they've had in a bit. Because, I mean, those are pretty much two NFC playoff teams. At least last year.
Damn, that's crazy. The Eagles won 34-28.
Oh, wow, really?
Justin Jefferson went off again, 11 catches, 159 yards.
I think I only got him in one league, bro.
I got him in three.
Oh, my God. Kirk Cousins had 30 fantasy points, and I benched him.
Yeah. Jeez.
He had more than Hurts.
Swift had 27.
He must have cooked in the fourth quarter.
Devontae got 26. Okay.
He had 4 touchdown passes.
Okay, Devontae Smith, I see you.
Dude, they must have had quite the fourth quarter crawl.
Addison gave me 16 points. I'll take that. Hurts gave me 25. Elliott gave me 12.
Honestly.
And Kirk Cousins has 28 in the league.
Honestly, the only thing that saved me from getting swept last week was Dallas' defense. I had them in two leagues.
I had the Jets' defense, and I benched them. I was so sick about that.
A dude in my league had Brandon Aiyuk. and the Dallas D, and who's the other guy? I want to say maybe Tyreek Hill, probably not Tyreek Hill. But a third guy that had like 30 points. He had like he finished the week with like 198 points.
I'm mad. I have Michael Pittman Jr. on my bench, and now I'm loaded with like four receivers. I have Jefferson, Davante Adams, Amon-Ra St. Brown, and Michael Pittman Jr. And I can't play Michael Pittman Jr. this week.
Oh, I just remembered I can put Kelsey. And ooh, I can also put what's his name, Jerry Jeudy in too.
I think Kelsey should be playing. Hopefully, we'll see.
I'm about to do that right now. I'm gonna put them both in, Kelsey and Jerry Jeudy.
I'm really in seven fantasy football leagues, and I don't know how it happened, and I don't want to do this again. Four was my limit, and then my social circle grew, so now I'm in seven. I'm just like, shit.
Okay, should I start James Conner at flex or Jerry Jeudy?
I don't even think Jeudy's playing because of the hamstring.
He is now. He got upgraded.
Who are the Broncos playing?
I wouldn't trust anybody on the Cardinals offense.
Broncos are playing Washington, which I'm pretty sure they have a pretty good secondary, no?
It's kind of mid. They have like one.
It says opponent ranked sixth.
Yeah, I know. I saw that too.
And then James Conner, they're playing the Giants.
I have a Cortland Sutton, so I had the same conundrum. I don't know, man. I mean, their offense looked better than last year, but it still didn't look like elite. So I wouldn't put too much stock in the Broncos.
I'm never putting stock into the Broncos. The Broncos have never beaten the Las Vegas Raiders.
That's wild.
In life.
You
know who also went undefeated? Jared Goff. He's never lost to Patrick Mahomes. First season, Eli. No chips yet, but you know. Like if Jared Goff leads
if
the Lions to a deep playoff.
If Jamal Williams goes off, I'm gonna be so mad. I started Madison.
Jamal Williams.
Yeah. For the Saints.
Oh yeah. I don't know why I was thinking. You know, like I think of Jamal J A M A L, not J A.
Yeah,
I know what you
mean.
Yeah.
I do the same thing. I always have to double check his name when I spell it.
I keep forgetting Rashid. Shahid is a receiver, not a running back, but I got him on my lineup, so I ain't tripping.
All right, so moving on to real life, since we all got our shit off with fantasy, what's the game of the week this week? It's Niners?
Nah.
Cowboys, Jets? Dolphins, Pats? Low-key,
I still say Cowboys Jets.
Low-key, I'm kind of drawn to two games for opposite reasons. I'm drawn to the Raiders and the Bills because I want to see like if the Bills bounce back. And I'm also kind of drawn to the Ravens and the Bengals because I want to see if the Bengals bounce back. Like, I feel like the Bengals can't be as bad as they looked last week. But also, didn't I tell you Cleveland was going to be a tough out? And you were like, oh, no. They lost a lot of guys.
Did I say that?
Blah, blah, blah.
Are
yeah,
you sure
you
said that?
You did. You said they were going
to. Are you really pounding the table for the Cleveland Browns?
No, I just said they're going to be a good team. They're going to be a hard out. And you were like, nah, they might be trash. They're definitely going to be last in division. Blah, blah, blah.
I didn't say all that.
You said they were definitely going to finish last.
I like them more than I like the Steelers. I don't know if I said that.
I don't think you said that.
I think
I think
we were talking in fantasy purposes because you were picking defenses,
right? We were talking on the air week one. We were for our whatever season preview like 2 or 3 weeks ago when we were talking about division. It was like the last time we were at the studio.
Hmm.
And you were like, yeah, the Browns or whatever, blah, blah, blah.
Honestly? Yeah, sorry. That hit me at a random time. I wasn't expecting a yawn.
Yeah, because you're laying in your literal bed. Like, what do you think is going to happen?
That shit is so comfy, though. Like, this is unmatched. But nah, I have to say, I still need to see more out of Cleveland. Because they just have the Bengals number. So, I mean, like, Cincy has to prove they can run the ball. Like, they remind me of the old Colts offenses where all you have to do is punch them in the mouth and just give them no room to breathe. Like, you just, like, throw them into a phone booth and beat the shit out of them and they can't recover. they kind of remind me of that. Those old Peyton Manning, Marvin Harrison, Reggie Wayne teams. I can never get past the Patriots. That's what the Bengals are turning into before our eyes. And I also think the window's closed for the Buffalo Bills, but I thought that before the season.
Oh, no, I think the thing with the Bills is their whole receiver situation, the whole Stephon Diggs, I feel like.
It's the offense.
Some in the water. Like,
it's the offense.
Like, they're just not vibing.
The offense is bland. Josh Allen has not really progressed that much as a passer. Everybody shits on Lamar. Lamar's actually shown progression, even though he got hurt. When is Josh Allen, like, truly progressed as an elite pocket passer? He doesn't. He just runs because he's big as shit and he's fast. He's a more aggressive Ben Roethlisberger, and I don't see how he'll last anywhere near as long as Ben Roethlisberger, because Ben learned to play from the pocket and manipulate defenses, and Josh Allen isn't doing that because you shouldn't be throwing three picks to Jordan Whitehead. Yeah, this was after Aaron Rodgers went out, because Aaron Rodgers only played four snaps.
Yeah, I don't know, man. I feel like it's weird because I feel like some teams, like nobody really played anybody at all this preseason. Like none of the teams really did. And
I mean, that's the standard now.
I know, and that's what I'm saying.
One less preseason game and the starters don't play.
I feel like it didn't really make a difference. Like, I feel like there were teams that looked sloppy and there were still teams that looked good. Like,
but you know who the preseason is for, right?
The
bottom half of the roster.
90, yeah. Obviously.
The bottom half of the roster. Like, so, obviously. And a lot of guys did great in the preseason, and now they're getting time, which is great. So, I think it's better this way.
I don't think so, because I think there's some teams that, like,
I think if you're Josh Allen, you don't need the preseason to play an elite quarterback.
I think there's some teams that looked, like, really out of sync.
So, the Bills?
Like, really out of sync. The Bills, the Bengals.
The Bears.
The Seahawks.
But, I mean, the Bears, I just think that offense.
But then there were teams like the Packers and the Rams who really looked in sync.
But that's because all the teams
the
that.
The Browns, they looked good.
All the teams that ran the ball well looked good.
That's pretty much, yeah. That's pretty much it.
And then also the Bengals cut Lyle Collins. Injuries. He was on the practice or the pup list, and they cut him off that. But my thing is, Jordan Love looked better.
Okay,
than,
wait, hold on.
Jordan Love looked better than Josh Allen. Explain that.
What do you mean?
Jordan Love looked better as a quarterback on Sunday than Josh Allen did.
And so did a lot of quarterbacks.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Jordan, I mean, he wasn't perfect, but he looked pretty good.
Like, for his first start, where it's his team.
Yeah, first start, yeah,
it's
for sure.
Aaron Rodgers kind of like, oh, shit, he's really the guy. The Packers made the right choice.
He just got the ball out quick. Good.
He got the ball out. He got it to the playmakers. He got the ball to Aaron Jones, even though both their receivers are hurt.
And Jones got hurt, too.
Musgrave fell down, and nobody was fucking near
what
him.
What I was going to say, though, before you brought that up, was this whole time I thought there was a glitch, but there are actually two games on Monday night.
This coming week?
Mm-hmm.
Because they usually have a Monday night doubleheader, right?
Yeah, but that's usually week one.
Yeah, that's what kind of probably threw me off.
There wasn't a doubleheader.
But it's not really a doubleheader because it's at 4 and it's at 5. So it's not really a doubleheader.
So two simultaneous games, pretty much.
Yep.
Why?
Ratings.
I don't know. That's why I thought when
Monday
I saw
Monday Night Raw.
I thought it was
no
a mistake when I saw it on the fantasy app, honestly.
I mean, Monday Night Raw is not. WWE is no longer being run by Vince McMahon.
What does that have to do with anything?
I was like, wait.
Endeavor owns that shit now, so
what does that have to do with anything?
You're going up against Monday Night Raw, or Monday Night Raw is going up against the NFL.
What are you talking about?
I feel like the NFL.
NFL is the number one.
That's what I said. That's why I said wrestling is going. It's a busy night, is what I'm saying.
Wait, what? We don't know what you're saying, Kenny.
Okay,
so just say what you're trying to say.
Since Vince McMahon doesn't really run WWE like that anymore. And this will be this past Monday was the last Raw, or last week was the last Raw that he had full control over. We're going to see a different program, a different wrestling program. People are going to be in tune to see that.
But he already took that, he had those like two or three gap years where he wasn't fully in
control.
No,
but like now, no, he was always in control. He just wasn't there.
Nah,
but now it's like
he
legally on paper does not run WWE like
that
anymore.
He's the CEO though.
He Endeavor owns that shit.
But he's the CEO.
No, he has creative control.
He's the CEO.
He still is, but he has creative control. He is beholden to Endeavor and other people now. Whereas he was
WWE
him.
Was
nobody
all,
to answer to before.
WWE was always a public company.
Bro, he was always
He always had shareholders to answer to.
It's Vince. It was Vince's show forever.
Bro,
when he,
took,
he got his
You need to call Raymond in, bro.
Bro, he got people he didn't
we
like
might have
out.
To call. We might have to call
You realize
Raymond,
he came
bro.
Back, Steph left, he... Like people that he
but
didn't
he,
want, he got
he
them out.
He, but he had those years where he wasn't in control because of his fucking health and shit.
You're not understanding what I'm saying.
I understand that he was still writing the checks. I got that.
No, no. Creative. He was running. He was making the decisions. Who gets the title? Who gets pushes? Like that shit is still all him, is what I'm saying. So now that it's different now. It's a slightly different era. People are going to be excited to see that, and it's going to be interesting to see what the ratings look like. Obviously, the NFL is going to come in one and two to whatever, but wrestling or Raw might look totally different going forward now as far as TV. So there's a lot of different elements, and I don't know how many people were expecting a week two doubleheader matchup. So, and if the games are trash, who are they playing? Who's playing next Monday?
This Monday, you mean? Saints, Panthers, Browns, Steelers.
Feels like a mid-off.
Bro.
There's actually a doubleheader.
Saints, Panthers actually looks...
Bro, those games aren't even going head-to-head with Monday Night Raw either. Monday Night Raw's at 8. That's after those games. So, again,
but
I still don't really know what you're
saying. This game's 3 hours. The game is 3 hours. The first hour of Raw is still competing with football.
I guess, man. I still don't really know how they're...
Said Welton knows what I'm talking about.
I still
about.
Don't know how they're correlated, bro.
Okay, but why is week two and week three Monday Night Football a
That's
doubleheader?
Weird, yeah.
Because
so weird.
2 weeks from now, it's Philly and Tampa Bay and also the Rams and Bengals.
That's a little bit more interesting. Super Bowl matchups. I mean, I don't know. They're trying to shake up the season, I guess.
I mean, is it because of the new... I don't know. Odd. She's a bit odd.
Yeah, I don't know, man. I mean, the Rams-Bengals should be interesting, assuming everyone plays next week.
Now, if the Bengals lose this game, I'm going to just be like, yeah, this validates the Super Bowl. Y'all can't say shit. You got.
I don't know about that. The Rams are totally different.
That's what I'm saying. Like, if
I don't know if you can
if
say
this
that.
Rams team beats this Bengal team, which
are you all on the Puka train like everyone else?
I mean, he's a possession receiver who went to BYU. What is the golden rule about possession receivers who went to BYU? They always make good pros.
Okay.
Every last one of them.
So you're in.
He'll be decent for a couple of years.
All right.
He's not going
to
be no 1,000-yard receiver.
That's what you said about Cooper Kupp.
Man, that's
different. Literally what you said about
I didn't
Cooper
say Cooper
Kupp
was going to be the best receiver in the league. I just said he's a high-volume receiver. Like if
you didn't think he was even going to be a Pro Bowler, bro.
Nah, I thought he'd be good. I thought he'd give you a couple.
You thought he'd be like a.
I thought he was better than Woody.
Receiver.
I thought he was better than Woody until that 54-51 game, and then I just shut up and I said, "Okay, he's him." But also, like Cooper Kupp is still not better than Jordy Nelson was. I'll go to my grave saying that shit. You want to know why? Jordy Nelson played outside, and he didn't need 10 catches a game to be effective.
I think it's because Jordy Nelson played for the Raiders.
Jordy Nelson played for the Packers, too.
Yeah, but it's because he played for the Raiders.
No, it's not. He was ass for the Raiders. I like to forget he ever played for the Raiders. Randy Moss is more of a Raider than Jordy Nelson
I
was.
Love Jordy Nelson, though. Like, I love him. I don't know why, but I've always liked him a lot.
He's dope. Man, he played safety at Kansas State, switched to receiver, became All-American. Him and Josh Freeman, you know. Josh Freeman was a first-round pick. He was a second-round pick. Actually was a premier deep threat in the league for a while before he got hurt. Like, Jordy Nelson was cold. Like, people say Cooper Kupp had better stats, but also I'm pretty sure if Aaron Rodgers was force-feeding the ball to Jordy Nelson the same way Cooper Kupp gets the ball force-fed to him, he would have better numbers because he was even faster.
I feel like he was fed to a point.
Jordan Nelson never had like 100 catches in the season.
He was kind of fed that year with the Raiders.
They force-fed him, but he was at the end of his career. He was force-fed the ball.
I know that.
Like, prime Jordy Nelson maybe got at most 85 catches.
Yeah,
he wasn't getting 90 catches a year. Like, if he was getting the targets that...
Well, they had receivers, too, then.
That's what I'm saying. Like, you had Devontae, you had James Jones, you had Greg Jennings, Jordy Nelson. Like, that receiver room was filthy stacked with three number one receivers. Like, and all of them shared the ball. So if you take any of those dudes and you see what Devontae does, give Devontae 115 targets a year. Oh, he just breaks the records, receiving record. Like, if you gave those dudes the same
amount of targets. I don't know how we started talking about Jordy Nelson. That's wild.
Because, like, people love talking about Cooper Kupp, but I'm like, he only plays inside, really.
And just remember.
And when he plays, he gets a lot of motion.
About an hour ago, Kenny said we were going to be under, and he didn't have a lot to say. But, yeah, here we are in a Jordy Nelson.
I'm saying Jordy Nelson was a vertical and outside receiver who could play inside. Cooper Kupp cannot really play outside like that and be a dominant. He's never been that guy. He's always been a slot guy who gets 10 to 15 catches a game.
I wouldn't go on that hill, bro.
Okay.
I wouldn't go on that
hill. We can go back and look
at his stats. He's big as fuck, bro.
He's 6'2", but he's an inside receiver. He gets a lot of motion. There's a lot of motion in that offense, in case you haven't noticed.
He's not physical.
I didn't say he wasn't, but he and Jordy Nelson are two different kind of receivers.
But what I'm saying is he has the size, he has the catch radius, he has a run routing ability.
What was his vertical?
So why would you say that he can't? But it doesn't matter what his vertical is. He's big and strong. So why would you say he can't? I don't see why you say he can't play outside.
Not the way Jordy Nelson played outside.
They run.
Jordy Nelson was burning Patrick Peterson. He was burning like elite corners, smoking them going deep. And everybody called him the slow white boy.
Know why you're comparing him to Jordy Nelson. They're not even like really the same player other than that they're white.
But my point is, Cooper Kupp is I was like, bro, y'all on the Cooper Kupp train when you really weren't rocking.
It's just because he's in
LA,
dude.
That's what I'm saying. You weren't hyping up Jordy Nelson the way you should have been. Jordy Nelson was a top 10 receiver for a good 4 years.
I mean, I would have higher than top 10.
I mean,
he's probably in that 6-7 range.
But think about the era of receivers he was in. Like, there's a logjammer receiver, bro. There are like 20 guys who played during that time who would be top 5 right now.
Damn, bro. You cannibalized your own shit. He had 2 years of 100 catches.
Shit, okay, fine. Like, barely, like, exactly 100?
98 and 97.
That's not 100, is it?
That's 100, bro.
That's not 100.
He had 150 targets.
Okay, how many?
150 targets. That's a lot of targets, my boy.
Yeah, but he didn't get 100 catches.
He still had 150 targets. That's getting force-fed the bot.
What were his touchdowns like?
Definitely. 14 and 13.
Okay, and what was...
And then he had 4 years, 5 years of 100 targets. He had 100 targets his last year with the Raiders.
I don't care about targets. I care about catches.
You should care about targets because that's you getting force-fed the ball. That's literally what you're talking about. That's literally what you're talking about.
He was the number one receiver in the offense, but I'm saying the Packers offense ain't like the Rams offense where the slot guy gets most of the catches.
Yeah, I don't know, man. I think we should just move on because I feel like you're kind of just rambling.
Not rambling. I'm just saying, Jordy Nelson was a better receiver than Cooper Kupp. And people need to be respectful of Jordy Nelson's greatness because he was better than a lot of receivers.
I don't know, bro.
If Jordy Nelson was black, he would get the credit he deserves. But he doesn't because he's white, and he was in an era where there were like 25 number one receivers.
I mean, Cooper Kupp almost has as many 1,000-yard receiving seasons as Jordy Nelson right now.
And if Jordy Nelson played in that Rams offense, he wouldn't
and have Jordy more production. And Cooper Kupp has never had that 150 targets.
Damn.
Look at his routes, though. Look at the kind of routes
he runs.
Can he
just stop?
I like Jordy Nelson,
too. I do, too. Like, I'm not trying to shit on Jordy Nelson, bro.
But let's not act like McVay's offense isn't based on a lot of motions, shifts, and short routes. Cooper Kupp's great. He's underrated as far as run after the catch, as far as I'm concerned. Like, he doesn't get the credit for how great he is.
I think
after
he has recently.
Honestly, he's only been a All-Pro twice. So I think it's really just because you live in LA, you have this idea in your head that he's like overhyped. But I really don't think he is.
He's not overhyped. It's just, it's McVay in that offense. And like, he's a great receiver, but is he doing the exact same thing if he was in Jordy Nelson's shoes? Where Jordy Nelson had, like, who else is stealing catches from Cooper Kupp in this offense? Nobody. Who was taking catches away from Jordy Nelson? Devontae, Jermichael Finley, a random tight end.
Bro, but I just told you, all the shit that you're saying is cap because he had a shit ton of targets, bro. He was getting the ball for us.
He was doing that in an offense that had Devontae Adams and Greg Jennings and other great players. And I'm saying the Rams have never had a Devontae Adams next to Cooper Kupp. Woody was close, but he wasn't Devontae. He was more like a James Jones. And I'm saying, if you put Jordy in that offense, I think he puts up even better numbers. Because he was primarily an outside receiver who could play inside. He became like a slot receiver with the Raiders. And we're just keeping it a beam. But whatever.
Yeah, bro. Slot receivers don't really get 100 targets like Jordy Nelson did. And at the time, they were running a lot of two tight end sets with the fullback. So they weren't even running that many.
They weren't running
three
shotgun
receiver sets.
Stafford runs a lot of shotgun.
And they didn't even really have another outside receiver outside of
a young Devontae.
Amari. They didn't have. I'm talking about the Raiders.
Okay. I mean, young Amari was still cold. 89
yeah,
was
young Amari was raw.
89 was an ugly ass number.
It's one of the.
He was like, baby Torrey Holt.
That's one of the most technically gifted, great receivers like I've ever. I've actually seen.
Crabtree or Cooper?
Definitely Cooper.
Okay, cool. I just wanted to make sure you weren't smoking that hopium.
But yeah, I think that's a good comp for him, like a Torrey Holt or Isaac Bruce.
Nah, he was because he was thicker. You know, he's a little bit stronger than Bruce, but
he's not as tall as T.O.
Yeah.
So.
But he was on some baby Torrey Holt vibes. Like Cooper Kupp is kind of in that same.
I don't know. You might be able to give him some T.O. because he'd be breaking tackles like T.O.
No, when he goes up against Rasul Douglas and he takes his fucking soul. Bro, I hate anytime I see him going up against Rasul Douglas, I'm like, no, get him safety help. His short area quickness.
All right, let's
move
on.
His short area quickness.
We've been dragging on this topic for a while.
Bro, so many cut ups of Amari Cooper just taking people's ankles.
Yeah, shit's crazy.
And it's like, it's offensive. Like, why would you put the third corner, the slot corner on this man? Did you check his 40 time? His shuttle? He ain't got the foot speed to keep up with Amari Cooper. Pick a route. Just tell Amari Cooper to pick her out. But Ridley was a great pickup.
Well, yeah, before we move on to college football, just a shout out to Mike Williams. Passed away this past week.
He was hit the head with a steel beam while at a construction site. He was 36.
It was reported that he died like a few weeks ago, but he actually wasn't dead.
He was still fighting for his life, and he got taken off of life support, but he didn't make it, unfortunately. And it's... left behind some kids. He's one of my favorite receivers. I think he went to Syracuse. Yeah, he went to Syracuse, if I'm not mistaken. He was like a second round pick. He killed it for the Buccaneers when they were trash.
Who was the other receiver that died as well on the Bucs? He actually played with Mike Williams. You know what I'm talking about?
I don't remember his name, but I know who you're talking about.
I can't believe it's escaping me, but it's crazy that they both, there were one and two, and they both died.
Yeah. Sad. Kudos. Just, you know, prayers up for his family, his loved ones.
36, man, it's crazy.
5 years older than us. Or Pete and I.
All right.
Are you skipping Monday Night Football again?
Didn't we talk about that? Oh, fuck. Yeah, you're right. We didn't pick last week. You're right. We didn't pick last week. Well, hey, this is a better time since it's a fucking doubleheader. Whoop. All right. What's the spreads?
Let's see. I had it, but then I lost it. I thought you had it. Look at you.
I got Saints over Panthers regardless.
You need the spread to make a decision?
I don't care about the spread.
You don't like the vibes?
I'll take the Saints over the Panthers, and I'll take the Broncos. I mean, the Browns over the Steelers. Okay. I think that's pretty cut and dry.
Yeah, I definitely got Browns over Steelers.
So I think that's why the either the point spread or the over under kind of makes it.
Okay, Kenny, what about you?
Yeah, I already said I had Saints over Panthers.
You're going Saints and Browns too?
Yeah, I said Saints that's first. I said Saints first.
What's the over under? Give us the over under.
I don't need
or we can pick a score.
I'm picking against Kenny Pickett almost every game. Yeah.
I'm trying.
The way they played against the Niners, I'm not convinced.
And then, so you're taking the under.
Miles Garrett is abusing the Steelers.
So
like
you're taking the under.
Over-under is 39.5.
Oh, we got a bet.
For the Saints or the Panthers?
I don't know if I'm legally allowed to take over-unders.
I will take the... I'll take the under. Yeah, I'm going to take the under. So I'm going to take the under on both of them. It'd be a late night game. You're going to be out of rhythm because it's a fucking Monday. Well, all four of those teams, I guess the Browns had the best offense of the four teams. But even them, I mean, who knows? Especially Steelers pass rush.
J.C. Horn.
It's 38.5 for the Cleveland and Pittsburgh.
Really? That one's lower?
That's crazy. The over?
Just by a point.
That's over?
Over under.
Yeah, I'll take under.
38 points?
38.5.
I'm definitely taking the over for both.
All right, so there you
Here's
go.
The thing.
That's our tiebreaker.
The Panthers don't have their best corner, J.C. Horn.
Okay, I have like a whole doc.
He's out for a while.
Perfect.
So the Saints are going to have some. If you got Chris Olave, might be a great night for you. So I'm taking Saints for 17.
I'm thinking. I would.
You ain't
got to
pick a scorer. I'm just saying.
I would say Saints under, and then I would say Pittsburgh under.
Really? You're going to pick Pittsburgh, huh? That's wild.
Interesting. I think Pickett will have
They didn't score one point last week.
Yeah, they'll bounce back.
Against Miles Garrett?
Wait, what do you mean they
didn't
score?
That man was doing basketball dribbles.
Did they get shut out last week?
That's the Giants.
Oh, yeah. Giants
You realize, Miles Garrett was, literally dribbling against air one-on-one before he beat the shit out of the entire, offensive line.
Look, I'm...
By himself. The man was...
I'm not...
All right, bro. College commercial. Football. We're already an hour in. Mister, I don't have a lot to say this week. All
right, cool. So, USC. Shout out to Texas for beating Alabama 34-24. Is Texas...
Hook 'em.
Is Texas back...
Warns.
No, I was only hook him to his horns down.
Bro, no, for real.
His horns up just that one day.
Like, Texas fans have just been coming out of nowhere. Like, whoa, how about them Longhorns? Like, bro, chill.
Like, you got your lick back.
Not even from Texas.
You got your lick back.
Texas, my guy.
You got your lick back for Colt McCoy.
You wear boots and go to country bars. Like, that doesn't make you a UT fan.
I saw a guy at the USC game. He had a UT hat and a USC polo on. I wanted to punch him in the face. I've never seen such a disgusting,
My buddy does that. My buddy who went to TCU, he does that.
Masochist.
And he has USC season tickets.
Oh, my God, I had this friend.
Masochist.
I had this friend who, he does sports media. He was on the field for a Stanford versus TCU playoff game, bowl game. And he had...
Stanford and TCU.
Yeah, it was like a bowl game. I don't know. It was a few years back. But he had a Stanford hoodie on, right? And, he had a TCU hoodie on. But then he wanted to get a picture with one of the Stanford players. He runs onto the field, rips his TCU hoodie off to reveal a Stanford shirt and takes a selfie with the guy. He got on the cover of ESPN for being a snake.
A snake.
Yeah.
I mean, both those schools got domed up in their boat. And
can you imagine getting caught in 4K like that, though?
That's nasty work.
Literally everyone in thousands of comments calling him KD. It was hilarious.
Damn. Pretty nasty work.
He deserved it, though.
Yeah.
Even the Stanford player, I can't remember who he took a picture with. He was like,
what are you doing, bro? You're a grown man. This is embarrassing.
He's like 18, but yeah. Technically grown, I guess.
Oh, well, in this case, it's just... But he's probably going to do that at 38. He's going to have that framed in his house.
He went to Texas A&M, too.
Ugh.
So, I don't even know what his problem is.
That's even worse, bro. That's like going to Arkansas and rooting for Ole Miss.
It's crossing three different conferences.
That's just like loving the like that's nasty. And USC beat the living dog piss out of Stanford in what could potentially be their final game ever playing each other, since Stanford and Cal are going to the ACC and USC is going to the Big Ten. USC won 56-10. Miller Moss said,
"When you do that, God, bro, can you mute me?"
You just said that.
Yeah, man.
Nah, I mean, when you just like rub your hand over the mic, what the fuck is that supposed to mean?
What else would it mean?
I don't know. That works too. Yeah. So, Miller Moss. Okay, it's weird. You throw me off. Anyway, so Miller Moss had like a 15-yard touchdown run to end the game. But when it comes to USC and Stanford, USC's pretty much dominated the series. They scored 49. It was 49-3 in the first half. Caleb Williams literally threw like a 75-yard touchdown pass to Brennan Rice, and it was in the air for like 65 yards. It was amazing. But ironically, even though they beat them 56-10, Zachariah Branch had a 75-yard punt return for a touchdown. Ironically, they gave him 196 yards rushing, but that was really it. And that was only because like two busted plays, a 22-yard, a 29-yard run, and a 59-yard run. Other than like power, like pretty much that's, and even then, that was against like their second string guys for USC. USC's first half defense pretty much pitched dominance. So I'm gonna go ahead and play good old Lincoln Riley's response.
After Lincoln, how do you feel the defense kind of reacted, especially after, you know, the amount of rush yards going up tonight, and where do you feel like the defense stands after three games?
Good, you know. Got pressure on the quarterback. Harry got out a couple times awesome. Really, other than that, there wasn't much else. We caused turnovers. We did pretty much everything that really, really good defenses do.
Yeah, so he killed it. He did the thing, and also talked to Zachariah Branch. Ironically, Michael Jackson III had a 74-yard punt return touchdown called back for holding. And on Zachariah Branch's punt return, he made three cuts and ran up the middle of the field, gone 75 yards. But there was like a flag on the play, but it wasn't on USC. But he was like worried. But yeah, like now his official touchdown dance is a Ronaldo celebration. But it's crazy, like the entire stadium yelled with him this time when he did that celebration. So, yeah.
Sounds like the net. Sideline. How much were you laughing, like, every time you saw them pooched or just, you know, directional kick it out of bounds?
Yeah, I was just like, man, I wanted to get the opportunity right there, but I was like, hey, can't do nothing about it.
Have you ever been involved?
Yeah. So, the fact that they kept kick, like, I was like, they're not going to kick to him, are they? And then they kicked it to him, and everybody in the press box was like, oh, my God, he's going to score. Because, like, with him, it's just a buildup. It's like he'll break one, the next return will be, like, 10 yards, and then the next one, it's like the heavens open up. He just gets a lane, and if he makes two guys miss, it's a foot race, and it's like as soon as he accelerates, you're not catching him, and especially nobody on Stanford was catching him. But yeah, right after he scored the touchdown, he pointed at the sideline and was laughing. He's like, I know what y'all doing, but that's also a sign of respect, you know, to a kick returner where you just kick it out of bounds. But, they're on a bye week this week. And then they play at Arizona State next Saturday. And then after that, they play at Colorado, which honestly, the way Colorado is getting disrespect from everywhere, and Jay Norvell, who went 2-10 last year at Colorado State, he was at Nevada previously. He He was the one who was coaching up Carson Strong and all those guys. But he said, you know, my mother taught me when I'm talking to adults to take my hat off and my glasses off. And it was pretty much a direct shot at Deion Sanders because he keeps his hat and his shades on during interviews, which he's been doing that his whole life. So I don't know why coaches are trying to make that a thing. This might be the last time Colorado and Colorado State play each other for a while. Big showdown. When I talked to like cats at Mountain West Media Day, how they felt about it. You know, they were excited. Colorado was kind of trash the past couple of years before Deion got there. But this is a little bit different. And people are saying they might put up 77 to 80 points on Colorado State. Again, the Mountain West is a good conference, but there are some bad teams in it. So I don't know what Jay Norvell was thinking when he said this, but to quote Deion Sanders, well, now it's personal. So Colorado probably going to do some very volatile things to Colorado State this week. And then and also another coach from another school who said something slick about Colorado that they play in 2 weeks. So it's going to be real interesting. I think people just really should keep Colorado's name out their mouth because they have all the momentum right now. They're really the story of college football outside of Bama losing and people saying, oh, Nick Saban should retire. And if he does, Deion Sanders would definitely be the guy to take over to Alabama. I mean, that's kind of been a notion that's been out there for a while. And honestly, yeah, if Nick Saban did retire, I would put all my money on Deion Sanders being the head coach at Alabama. And then it's over for everybody because you're not out recruiting Deion Sanders. As far as other stuff in college football,
I was going to say, unless he goes to the NFL.
Nah.
Which is becoming more and more of a possibility.
He always said he never wanted to coach the NFL because he got to deal with grown men, and that's different. And if you make your son the starting quarterback and he sucks, grown men ain't going to want to hear that shit.
See what happens. Now he's at the table. Now he can,
I think.
Now he can ask for whatever he wants. If he keeps up what he's doing this season, he'll be able to ask for a king's ransom.
But that power vacuum disappears once you go to the NFL. Nick Saban tried that.
No, there's
shit.
No doubt about that, Kenny. No one's debating that. I'm just saying.
Yeah.
I don't know if he. It's one thing to turn down an opportunity when it's not a possibility. It's another thing when they come knocking at your door, doubling your number, to say no to that. Because remember, he also wasn't jumping at the bit to go
leave Jackson State.
Exactly.
But that was different. I don't think he never was going to stay at HBCU that long.
I don't know. He positioned it that way. No, he PR'd it.
He hit him with the black preacher talk, but people in Mississippi are still kind of pissed about some of the shit he did. It's all channels and people talking about it, journalists who got kicked out and weren't allowed to cover certain things. So that how he left Jackson State already is messy in itself, but it's no better. It's no different than what Brian Kelly did, except Brian
Which
Kelly.
Which time?
Exactly. Except it's no different than what Lincoln Riley did, if we're being honest.
Yeah, and I...
Lincoln Riley actually did worse because he took the future of Oklahoma's program, a megastar, to Hollywood.
I mean, that's pretty much what they did. I mean, Oklahoma...
I feel like Deion was kind of worse, but...
Deion was worse in totality because he took a whole roster.
And he messed up Colorado, too. Like... The roster that was there.
Yeah, but all those kids weren't good enough. They were 1-11, so they either found a school or they didn't.
Yeah, but like, do you hear yourself?
That's how football works. Football's an evil, fucking, heartless game. Like, you have to be something has to be wrong with you to want to play this shit. It's sports is unforgiving.
Talking about kids who can only go to Colorado because they're on athletic scholarship there.
Yeah, life it's sucks. Not okay. Life's hard.
It's arguably worse than what Lincoln Riley did.
It is, but...
Oklahoma can and will recover. Jackson State won't ever.
Nah, they're actually pretty good this year, but they won't recover the way they could have recovered. There's some truth to that, but the whole...
I saw them get their shit rocked by Florida A&M, didn't they?
But that's different, though. One of their players left the day...
Oh, my God. What's your phrase today, bro? That's different.
One of their players left. At least I'm not saying that's nasty work. But now one
I haven't
of
even said that once today.
You're on air. Okay, I would say. But now, like, one of their players for Jackson State literally left to go to FAMU, like, 2 days before the game. So,
I mean, like,
that's usually when you go to another school and all of a sudden they know, like, they shift their whole formation on offense because they know somebody gave you their playbook. I don't know. It's a lot of
Why did Lincoln Riley get so much heat, but Deion Sanders didn't, is my question.
Deion Sanders got hella heat. He's still getting hatred.
He's getting heat.
He got the most heat. He got the most heat, and what he did is something that...
Lincoln Riley got more heat.
I feel like Lincoln Riley got less heat because it was like...
He got no heat in L.A.
Lincoln Riley got more heat.
He got no heat. He got all... People broke into his house.
Of course he didn't have any heat.
He got all the heat in Oklahoma. He got no smoke on the West Coast.
Well, duh, because he's coming to the West Coast.
Colorado broke out the red carpet more than USC did for Lincoln. Because Colorado's never been a winner. Colorado's been ass forever.
Didn't they buy him a mega mansion?
They didn't have the money to pay Deion Sanders. They had to get it from the everybody else. And then they called Jackson State broke.
I mean, Jackson State had the money to pay him. Shitty things, but I think Lincoln Riley got more heat for it, to be honest.
I mean... I don't know. It's not really shitty, but
it's extremely shitty. You're just biased.
In closing,
the entire world thinks it's shitty except you.
I mean, it's fair game.
It's not fair.
It's life ain't fair.
So it's fair, but now it's not fair.
As a black man in America, life is not fair.
So now it was fair, but now it's not fair. But it's okay that it's not fair.
No, that's the rules of college football. None of this shit is fair.
Kenny, you looking like Bukowski wearing a 15-year-old sweater, bro.
None of this shit is fair. None of it is fair. Look at me. None of this is fair.
You wearing a crop sweater in your own bed is not fair right now.
First off, I'm leaning back. That's why the hoodie looks like that.
Let it go, bro.
Shut up. No, it's just a comfortable hoodie. It still fits. Fuck you. But now, like what Colorado
that's
did.
Fitting?
Shut up. How about that?
What's small? What's small is Zeke T? Like that small for you?
Shut up!
Like, oh yeah, it's a little too small. Whole drip, midriff though. Like,
I could do that. I could pull the midriff. Look off. I'd be hella comfortable too.
Bo's just trying to relax in his own bed. You
shouldn't. Like the point of a midriff is my comfort, not yours. The point of this hoodie is my comfort, not
That's
yours.
A dude who has like 5 episodes slandering Lizzo, but okay.
I didn't slander Lizzo. Lizzo's a horrible person. That's why she got slandered.
I'm just saying. Like
when people in your own camp are slandering you and they were making you the face of anti-bullying and you turned out to be the biggest bully, tale as old as time. Anyway, yeah, I'm off college football. Deion Sanders did what he did. Everybody who says it's not fair, you're still going to buy tickets and go to the game. So I guess that makes you a hypocrite.
I'm not.
You work in a stadium, so how are we? I mean,
do you see how much those tickets cost?
And you're a part of the
$517 for Jeez. A ticket.
Technically, you're part of the problem. That's all
for that game.
For the call, an averaged out Colorado ticket.
Yeah, and it's sold out.
Number one.
Oh, the whole season.
Yes.
Yikes. Number one most expensive.
You're pay $500.
That's more than fucking SoFi and fucking.
Can you imagine your
that's
team?
That's a quarter.
Being
that's
shitty?
Half of a Beyonce ticket. That might be a whole Beyonce ticket.
That is a whole Beyonce
imagine
ticket.
Imagine your team. Being so shitty for so long, your alumna, like you, whatever, right?
Colorado's a rich
and
ass.
And you guys finally get good, and you're so excited. You
pay for
finally
it.
Go to a game. Tickets are $500. So fucked up, dude.
Hey, man.
So fucked up.
Winning is worth its
weight in gold. Yeah, I know.
Yes, and blood. Don't forget that.
I'm not saying it isn't, but it's still fucked up nonetheless.
Yeah, totally.
Colorado got to make that money back, but like still, it's fucked up.
They're gonna
up.
Make that money back.
I just can't imagine.
Dude. They just can't keep Deion Sanders, so they better hope they can. They win the Big 12 next year.
Yeah, I don't know about that, but maybe. Shit, with Texas and OU leaving, I mean, there's no one else really. But
it's gonna be the Air Raid Conference. That's what the Big 12 is gonna be next
the
year.
What?
The Big 12 is just gonna be the Air Raid Conference next year. No defense will be played. None.
Yeah, everybody talking about Big 12 don't have any defense.
They don't.
I think it's more like Big 12 offense, not Big 12 defense. Not gonna lie.
All right. Ready for the next segment?
Yeah, been ready. Let's do it.
All right. We got a special edition of Touchdown or Turnover, calling it Boomer Bust.
Yes, sir. We thinking like open ended.
However you want to do it. You're the producer. You decide whatever you think is better.
Shoot the starter pistol. All
right. Any notable week one booms?
Jordan
Addison.
That y'all want to shout out?
Shout out Jordan Addison.
Shout out Mac Jones. Ain't nobody gonna talk about him except me.
Yeah, low key, Mac Jones did ball.
He actually went off.
They lost.
I considered they lost.
Oh, I'm sorry. Against the reigning NFC champions by 1 foot not hitting the ground in the fourth quarter with 24 seconds left. My bad.
Yeah, I mean they lost.
My bad.
You know who gets three tutties
over 300 yards? Yeah, I'm gonna keep
Tyreek Hill talking
about Mac Jones.
You know who boomed? I'm gonna take back what I mean. Jordan Addison gets honorable mention, but you know who really boomed?
That would be this week.
I mean, he boomed last week. He scored a touchdown last week.
And he had, like, what, 11, 12 points? He didn't have that many points.
He still scored a touchdown last week.
But that's not a boom.
Fine. Then Jimmy Garoppolo.
That's not a boom.
That's a boom?
Confident. Like 16 points, bro.
We're not talking fantasy. I'm talking real life.
Can I talk my shit again? Baker Mayfield. Baker Mayfield. What you think, Kenny? Boom or buzz this week? Go ahead. Any comment?
Wow. That was racing the whole time, wasn't it?
No, I really wanted to talk about Mac Jones. But yeah.
I mean,
that's pretty nice to watch, wasn't it?
The Bucks are still trash, so.
Oh, okay.
They are.
Oh, and he's going up against Chicago's defense this week. Boomer bust, Kenny. How's he going to do this
week?
That's
a hella bust.
Oh, he's gonna do poorly against Chicago's 30th ranked defense.
He's gonna do poorly because Yannick Ngakoue is gonna get a sack on a clutch third down.
A sack.
Yeah, that's all you need. A sack, fumble.
Shout out to the Dolphins kicker Saunders. He gave me a 14 piece.
Is
this fantasy themed or are we talking real life?
Both? It can be whatever you want it to be.
Okay, cool. I still say Jimmy G though. That's a boom. Competent quarterback play.
Nick Chubb.
What did he do?
106 rushing yards, 4 receiving, 21 receiving yards. So like 20 something points.
I think Samaje Perine really showed up.
He did. I was thinking about you when he busted off that big run for a first down.
I didn't even get to see it. I was waiting for a table at B-dubs.
He bought. He bought for sure.
Part of me wants to still get some Samaje Perine, but
extremely.
I have what's his face? Back.
I'm Mixon.
Javonte.
I have Mixon in one of my leagues. I don't remember which.
I'm Mixon and Javonte, and I don't know if I want to play Javonte because I don't trust.
Yeah, I keep going back, but I think he had a decent week last week. He was on my bench, but
yeah. Shout out Samaje Perine. I'm really super proud of you, bro. Continue that grind. Continue that solid second back work.
Moving on to bus.
Yeah.
There's lots of them.
There's a lot of disappointing work this week.
Definitely Lamar Jackson.
Yeah,
I had him in two leagues.
I had him in one. I still won that week, though.
What the hell is that by your foot?
Roshi?
Don't fuck. I'm closing the window at night.
Bro, we didn't have no roaches before you. We didn't have no roaches before, bro.
I have no roaches in my shit when I came here. I don't know, man.
You be eating in here. We gonna be eating in the rooms like that.
It didn't look like a roach. What was it called?
A pincher bug?
It looks like a roach, but it's not a roach.
It probably was a pincher bug. Cause
the small ones are the bad ones. Small ones are the ones you have to worry about. No, the ones that fly, they die.
Okay.
The big ones die when they're out of water. It's the small ones that take over your house and fuck everything up.
Definitely wasn't a small one.
It was a mid-size.
Okay, well, it'll probably just die somewhere around.
Step on that shit if you see it.
Dude, I was scared. No, it was over here. It's like over by my feet somewhere. God, I mean, they're harmless. They're not going to hurt you.
No, there's nothing. That's nothing.
They're not going to. Oh, it was on the tip of my tongue. I had it.
Still, if you see that shit, kill it. Because I've been like. Nah, I don't play that shit. Like,
we haven't had no bugs here, bro.
Yeah, I've had no bugs.
I haven't had no bugs at all.
No bugs on the outside balcony. I even scrubbed this shit down earlier this week.
I don't know. I've never been real like against roaches because I know that they're well. Like, don't get wrong. I don't want roaches, but like they're
like a bug. Like
bugs that don't harm me, I don't care.
Like a bug, like flew on the fucking screen and I sprayed that shit. Like it annoys me.
I go crazy over spiders though. I will save every single bug in my house. I will save cockroaches. I will throw it out rather than squish it in my house. But a spider,
killing it.
I'll torture it and then kill it.
That's just evil. They're actually supposed to kill the shit that.
What, the spiders? Shit.
Spiders actually are the good guys.
Anything that would bite me, torturing it, then killing it.
I mean, technically, a cockroach could bite you.
All right, bus, Kenny.
I already said my bus.
I don't remember what you said.
Fuck, I forgot what I said. It was.
I don't think you said anything.
Mayfield? We're talking about bus for this week?
Bus.
Oh, my God.
Bus
Kenny.
This week one, and how do you think they may do improve or worse in next week?
Oh, well. I definitely think Mayfield's gonna be a bust next week.
No, bro, you can't just say that when he did good, like, and then he's going into Chicago.
It's the Vikings, aren't they? 0-2. The Vikings are 0-2, right? Their defense is still trash.
The Vikings? No, he's playing in Chicago.
Yeah, but he beat the Vikings, and the Vikings defense is trash. So
and
yeah, so he was a boom this week.
The Vikings
but
just lost
I don't
by
see
a
that
touchdown
as a
to the NFC champion.
I don't see that consistently holding up. Is what I'm saying.
So. So you're saying that he's going to bust against 30th ranked Chicago defense.
And if I had to say a future prediction, I think that like Jordan Love is going to keep rising.
Okay. Let's see.
What
about
the fuck?
You got any thoughts about Joe Burrow?
That shit's right there. It's annoying me now.
Was it a one-off?
I just saw it on the door. Fuck. It's annoying. Yeah, could you just kill that shit, please?
No, I don't like killing things that won't
like,
hurt me.
Kill that shit for real, though.
I'm not going to kill it.
I'm serious. Like,
what do you want me to do? Punch it?
Step on it. Fucking.
Bro, these might work.
That shit might reproduce. I'm not really trying to have that in here.
Yeah, dude, I lost it now. He go.
Terrible.
He go. Anyway, so what do you think about Joe Burrow? Was it a one-off?
More annoying than whatever that fucking little
bug
is.
Did he get paid and he's going to turn into, what's that dude, that Chicago quarterback that smokes?
Damn, you called him Jay Cutler? That's
Jay
fucked
Cutler.
Up. You called him Jay Cutler? His offensive line
off,
is...
He gives off Jay Cutler energy.
His offensive line is the real bust.
So you think he's going to be fine next week? What does he need to do?
I'm trying
to
figure out where that shit is coming from. No, I can't stop thinking about it.
What does Joe Burrow need to do week two to not
have a better
like
offensive line?
Two fantasy points.
Have a better
not
offensive line?
Not let TJ Watt have his will with him?
That interior line is... Like, they've put so much money into that offensive line, mm-hmm. and they still suck.
Rip. Any thoughts about Kenny Pickett?
I don't believe it. I don't believe the hype.
Well, I mean, there was zero hype for him this week.
That's what I'm saying. I'm like, I feel bad. I feel bad for all the receivers in that offense and Najee Harris because, like, it's not gonna go down.
Okay, then. Cowboys, Giants. Giants bust, or was it just a fluke?
That's the biggest fucking bust I've ever seen to get dog walked 40 to zip.
Daniel Jones bust?
That shit was wild.
That was disgusting work. I don't even feel comfortable.
I didn't think
Daniel
they were
going to
be that bad at
yeah.
all.
I didn't think. I thought it was going to be a good game.
Saquon's face said it all.
I thought Dallas was going to win, but I figured it'd be like 10.
I figured it would be slightly competitive, not 40-0. And their offense didn't even really
I don't
do
think
anything.
Nobody saw 40-0. And they dominated all three facets of the game.
It wasn't even close.
Like, they did a bunch of shit that no other team in history has done all in one game.
I think the Dallas Cowboys are the most complete team in the NFL right now.
That's saying a lot.
You're kind of not wrong.
I mean, I don't like saying that, trust.
Kind of not wrong. And they didn't lose anyone in injury. So it's kind of like, yeah.
I mean, the Steelers. I mean.
They're kind of the same team.
It's just clearly their quarterback position.
They're kind of the same team.
Yeah. So Daniel Jones.
I mean, the Rams looked really good, but I mean, that's kind of fucking lightning in a bottle. The Seahawks.
Right. So Daniel Jones.
The Dolphins looked good.
Daniel Jones got sacked, what, 8 times?
The Dolphins?
Cowboys.
I lost count.
Was that 40 to zip? Was that any part of Daniel Jones' fault or was his?
That was like 70% his fault.
Really? Getting sacked 9 times?
You can't
times?
Get paid
Eight,
that
nine
much.
Times?
You can't get paid that much money and be that ass.
He had 0.8 seconds on average in the pocket. during the game.
Well, I guess the O-line should have blocked better.
Dak Prescott had 3.7 seconds average in the pocket.
Brian Daboll, I don't know what the fuck he was doing.
Why do I know that? I don't know. I just read it the other day. Less than a second in the pocket on average.
As a quarterback, your job is to shift the protection. So, like...
Daniel Jones ain't built to be a scrambler. That's not what he's paid for.
He ran like a 4-5.
Honestly, I stopped watching the game that closely once it got out of hand. Like, it was just on.
I fell asleep like I was drinking, taking shots.
Yeah. I was at work and I was like, and one of my coworkers is a Cowboys fan. I was
waiting for some ribs.
I looked over, I was like, God damn.
If the ribs would have been done at halftime, I would have left from watching the game at halftime. That's the only reason why I watched the whole game was because I was waiting on the fucking ribs to finish.
So do you really think
for my roommate because I'm a good friend? So there you go.
My nephew.
I didn't even eat any of that second rib. I literally gave you the full half.
And my nephew devoured it in 5 minutes.
Yeah.
So yeah.
Did he go slap his mama after?
I don't know.
He probably did.
He'll do ribs
so good.
He'll slap.
I'm about to slap my mama.
But like just to wipe his hands, not to like slap you out of like malice.
Yeah, like, come that's here, the whole point.
Like, damn, this kid's a smart
that's
ass.
The whole point.
Y'all seen that thing where it said that this guy says, make you want to kick a fat kid at Kmart? You seen that?
Nah.
Never want to, I mean, I've never been kicked at Kmart.
Makes you want to kick a fat kid at Kmart.
I've heard that somewhere, but like, I haven't.
I've never heard,
like,
that saying, and I feel attacked.
Dog, I haven't even been to a Kmart.
It's like the same energy as like slap your mama.
Kicking a fat kid at Kmart, like, you don't know that fat kid. You're just kicking a fat kid. It's funny.
You would rather slap your mother? I would rather kick a kid at Kmart.
I mean, I'm not afraid of death, but because as a kid, I slap.
Because if they're shopping at Kmart, there's a 95% chance that child is unattended. So you could just kick him. No one's going to know.
That's fucked up, though. That's abusive child abuse predator behavior. That's like, you're just openly admitting, like, I'll kick the shit out of an unattended fat kid. But, like, slapping my mom... In a moment of euphoria, I mean, it depends on, like, how hard the slap is.
The consequences are just so much less when it comes to the kid.
But, I mean, like, when you're under 4, you can slap your mom and not get fucked up. 5, you might catch a beatdown. Under 5, you can slap your mom and it'd still be playful.
So, all right.
Okay, closing out boom or bust. Are the Jets... boom, or is it, Bill's bust.
Bill's definitely a bust.
What happened?
Bill's definitely
a bust. Is
Zach
Wilson actually him? Will he lead the Jets this year?
Zach Wilson should get them to 10 wins because their defense can keep them in games. And all you have
to
do
is... I mean, that's what we said last year, though.
Throw it to 17. Throw it to your playmakers. Hand it off to Breece Hall. Don't fuck it up. And he's his second year... He got the confidence of A-Rod, or A-Rod's confidence in the room and reassuring presence.
The line is reshuffled and healthy.
I mean, they got guys playing out of position.
They got more skill players.
Like, Elijah Vera Tucker just needs to be playing guard, not tackle. Dwayne Brown also.
The team is definitely better, even without Rodgers, than it was last year.
Yeah.
Like, I just think he just needs confidence and push and support. But they still have everything in front of them, and they're 1-0. You got to remember that too. You're 1-0. You lost your quarterback, but you're still 1-0. You still have an elite receiver. You have tight ends. You just need to keep the ball moving and score points. If this offense scores 24 points a game with that defense, that's 11 wins. That should win the division, because Buffalo's looking one-dimensional. Very one-dimensional.
Yeah, I agree with that. I think a lot of it, too, was emotional. I think once Rodgers went down, which, by the way, I've been saying this, but if Rodgers would have just went down, he would still be playing. Like, I think
we don't know that.
I think that's one thing that Brady really got good at, especially, like, late the last couple years in
Tampa. He knew how to sit on his ass.
Exactly. He knew when he was done. He knew when he was cooked. He knew when Rodgers thought he was Ben Roethlisberger and tried to throw one guy and keep going. It's like, bro, one, you're not young. Your joints don't work like that anymore.
And it's turf.
Two,
turf caught his leg.
Two, you're on turf. Three, was a defensive lineman, not a DB. And four, you're not out here doing only resistant bands like my boy Tom Brady. Tom Brady don't lift weights. He only does resistance. So he's kind of built for that.
Yeah.
Yeah, he doesn't like the pressure on his muscles.
He's like, and I, what do I need to be?
He
super-
likes to just stretch them.
So self-righteous.
That's what he sells. That's his whole thing.
Shit, man. I guess he's
flexibility.
I mean, it works. Heck, it works. Like, what can I say? Shout out to our owner.
Speaking. Moving on to take your tangent.
I'm getting so
on the subject of Tom. Tom.
I hope Patrick he dresses up as a Raider logo for Halloween. Like, just a little shield like that. Just wear a hat, yeah, and his face over.
Get people screaming.
Yeah, it should be sick.
Anyway, Thomas Edward Patrick Brady III was returned to New England and returned to a hero's welcome, and he was prematurely inducted into the Patriots Hall of Fame during the Welcome Home Tom game.
They're waving. He'll be inducted next year. They're waving.
They inducted him on site, I thought. They gave him the thing, the plaque and everything.
Well, they pretty much waived him having to wait.
He was supposed to wait 4 more years, but then Robert Kraft said, fuck it, give it to him. And then they did.
Pretty much, yeah.
Yeah.
Better than fucking Bradley Zapp wearing his number 12.
Bradley Zapp.
Whatever.
Oh, Zapp wore 4.
I know, I'm just saying.
No one wore 12.
I'm just saying, it's better than anyone 12. Wearing 12.
No one's going to wear 12
legit
after
ever. Retire 12.
Like, it was really cool,
ain't no O'Connell wearing 4 is nasty.
Yeah, no one's going to. It was really cool. It was really awesome. It was emotional for sure. Emotions were high across the stadium. Brady was emotional. Fans were emotional. Robert Kraft was emotional. Everybody was crying. His kids were crying even. It was really sweet. It would have been really cool to cap off the game with a win against the Eagles, but, you know, things don't always work out. The script was written, unfortunately, but it was really awesome to see that and the way that he kind of settled back into New England and said that, like, New England is my one and true home, stuff like that. Sorry, Buccaneers fans, rip. but it was really awesome to see. It was really nice. It was some good closure. For sure. And it was really weird seeing him in a 12 jersey with zero pads on. I don't think I've ever seen him in a football jersey without pads.
I'll just say.
He didn't watch none of his Super Bowl.
Media availability.
He doesn't wear those. He doesn't wear the jerseys.
He did in the first one or two.
You never saw the parades?
When he was younger, maybe. Well, I mean, they're like different cuts, though. Like, they're not the official ones. They look different. Like, I mean,
the Nike one is cut different than the Reebok one back then.
Like,
for sure.
The ones that he wore to the parades are normal. Like, the one he was wearing at the thing, that was like all the way down to his elbows.
He probably didn't have one, and they probably gave him one and asked him to wear it. And he was like, all right, yes. And it was probably just whatever they had in the fucking utility closet.
I mean, I don't know. I find it hard to believe.
That's usually what they do.
His entire family. Because
usually celebrities don't really.
Every single one of his kids was wearing the jersey too.
Yeah, sometimes they don't be showing up with shit, and they know that they're going to be a guest, and it's like, bro,
but he's getting inducted.
You're a guest.
It's his game.
I've seen it happen.
They'll throw you a jersey.
They'll go to the closet and just get him whatever
All of his kids had their own jerseys that fit them
for sure. Yeah,
for kid version. Yeah. So I mean, I feel I don't know, but anyway, it was really cool and good for him and.
I think I agree with you, though. I feel like it's too early. Like, I feel like they could have did that in the middle of the season.
Too early for the Welcome Home Tom game?
Yeah, I feel like they could have did that in the middle of the season.
To be honest, I kind of wish it was...
like, build up to it, like...
Well, no, like, home opener. I liked it.
Well, now what else are you guys going to play for?
Well, Tom's not walking through that door, so...
What are we even playing for?
I mean, yeah, you're right, too.
Playing for a winning season.
That would have given me hope if I was a Pats fan. Like, at least... I had the Welcome Home Tom game to look forward to in week 12. Like, we don't have homecoming week 1 for a reason. Like, it's kind of like overkill. Like, it's week 1. You're already excited.
College.
You're already excited.
I don't know. I think it was good timing. It was the home opener. It was because it's a welcome home. It was everybody's welcome home, including his.
Yeah. Still lost. Got clapped.
That's sure they lost on Brady's.
They played well.
and lost to the Eagles.
I mean, they didn't. I wouldn't say clap. 5 points really isn't clap.
I mean, when you have when you have Brady there, that's a clappage.
Yeah, for sure.
And you lost to the
and
Eagles.
You're honoring him, and you lost to the Eagles in the Super Bowl.
Well, it's their.
That's like when they were, the Lakers were getting blown out. And
we
Kobe
won against
left.
The Eagles in the Super Bowl too.
Yeah.
So one and one, I guess.
I mean, let's be honest.
Should have lost that game.
You should have lost that game. One bad leg was whooping y'all ass.
Okay, and
if LJ Smith had, you know, just been able to fucking beat
should've,
receiver.
Should've, coulda, woulda.
Like, you barely won that game. Like,
okay, and we
you weren't the
lost
better team.
Other,
you just, like, T.O. didn't have, like, enough burst in his bad leg to get, and Donovan wasn't smart enough to throw him the ball more.
Okay, and Brady should've had two more rings, but crazy things happened in both the Giants.
Eli owns him. Shoulda, coulda, woulda.
All right, let's move on to the next one.
She's really offended at that.
No, bro, I keep hearing this. I literally was talking to someone at work earlier. Oh, yeah, you shouldn't have won the Rams Super Bowl. Y'all shouldn't have won that.
Because you cheated.
Yeah, you shouldn't have won that one.
Cheated?
You know,
it's
a like, it's a known fact y'all cheated.
You cheated.
You cheated to win that game.
No, it's dude, fucking. No, that's such a cap. Chill.
No, like, Jesus they God. Caught
no, like
you on
it's
video
canon.
Recording.
On what? Doing what?
Like, recording their plays.
Yeah.
You knew all their plays. Like,
are you serious right now? Are you trolling us?
You're trolling me right now. You probably brought a roach out your bag from the Coliseum just to piss me off. Because it was spot. I haven't
seen
anything.
If they had any
critter
proof,
in this room.
If they had any proof, they would have shot that shit down instantaneously.
They did have proof.
They literally
they
had proof
caught.
And got caught and got penalized.
Yeah, they got penalized.
And lost draft picks.
This is a known fact.
No,
like, this
it
wasn't the first time.
This is like Watergate.
So
like,
you think.
It happens.
You think.
No, I know.
You,
no, we
you
know.
We have facts.
It's known.
There's documentation. There's video of them doing it.
Yeah.
And getting caught.
Getting caught during the Super Bowl.
Yes.
No,
the
whole
Rams
week they were recording the Rams practices.
Yes.
Illegally.
Yeah.
Having
from
random
the wrong spot.
No, having random people sit in the fucking stands and
so
record.
So like the Jets shit all over again kind of thing?
The Jets weren't in the Super Bowl though. You recorded the team you're playing in the Super Bowl with the distinct purpose of getting an advantage and cheating. And you cheated and won.
Holy shit. I was talking about the recent Rams one. Holy fuck. I'm finally putting it all together. I'm talking about 2019.
No, I'm on 1990.
Fuck.
Oh, yeah. I mean, you
okay,
shouldn't
fuck,
have won that
bro.
Game
I was like,
either.
What the fuck are y'all talking
but
about?
But y'all won that game because the Rams didn't win.
I was like, bro,
the greatest
what?
Show on turf. I thought we were talking about that
I thought
one.
That's what we were talking about,
see,
too.
I was literally about to say, are you talking about
I was like, no,
Spy
the Rams like got their ass whooped in that game. Like,
no,
McVay
okay,
didn't
okay.
That
if
one
y'all
want to
talk about Spygate, that should be it.
But the
I could talk about that for hours.
But yeah, the Patriots shouldn't have won that game, but they won it because the Rams didn't win it. Like, the Rams should have won that fucking game.
Like, someone had to
I don't
win.
Care what anyone says. Like, you're down fucking 7 in the fourth quarter with 4 minutes left in the ball, and you can't fucking score, bro.
No one can score the
and
whole
you have an
day.
Offensive coach and an offensive
wait,
roster.
Wait,
the Rams choked. The Rams
wait.
Choked. McVay's Rams
I'm,
choked.
I'm saying you won the game. I'm
no,
just saying.
All I
like,
hear
the Rams,
are excuses all the time. All of Brady's
that's
Brady's
not an excuse. That's a fact.
No, y'all just said the Patriots didn't win that game. The Rams
I said
that
the
Rams.
I said, no, I didn't say that. I didn't
game.
Say that.
I
you
believe,
spun what I said.
I believe the Rams choked and lost that game and deserved to lose.
I said
with
the
McVay.
I said
but
verbatim.
The 99 one, y'all cheated.
I said verbatim.
Yeah,
the Patriots
no.
should have lost, but they won that game because the Rams did not win that game.
They didn't capitalize.
I didn't say the Rams lost. The Rams should have won, but they didn't. They
see,
had an opportunity
why
to
put
win.
Put an asterisk on every single one of
that's
the
not an
Patriots
asterisk.
Super Bowls.
It's not an asterisk.
It's only an asterisk on like two.
I
that's not
been,
an asterisk. I'm just saying
raised,
the Rams should
have
won. Like,
I have
that was an opportunity.
In defense mode because all ever anyone does is put asterisks.
Bro,
on
you've
Patriots
been winning
Super
championships
Bowls.
Since literally you came out the womb.
And you're not even from Boston. That's
yeah,
the crazy
like,
part.
Chill.
Like, you're hood hopping across like. The country.
So what did you want me to do? Become a Dallas Cowboys fan?
You could have.
Is that could've. What I should have done
been a Houston, you could have been a Houston Oilers, Tennessee Titans fan. You could have done that.
Why would have been a Tennessee fucking Titans fan? No one from Oklahoma is a Tennessee Titans fan. They're all either all Chiefs fan, which you would call me a bandwagon anyway.
And I wouldn't.
Or the
nah,
Cowboys.
Not if you were really
the Chiefs
a Chiefs fan.
Recently got, the Chiefs only recently achieved God tier.
Right.
We talk shit about
but
Chiefs
but they're
God
tier since before y'all knew me.
Since Mahomes.
So, yeah. Yeah, so
but
I mean,
yeah, if you
would have
if you
my two choices,
if you
would
have been like, yeah,
America's
I had an Eddie Kinnison jersey hanging on the wall
been,
when Rona,
I was a Dwayne Bowe fan.
Like, okay.
I was a Jamal Charles fan, even though I'm a Raiders
Larry Johnson.
Fan.
Okay.
I think we're gonna just forget about Larry Johnson.
Yeah.
He's kind of
I was not about to become
post.
A Dallas Cowboys fan.
I respect that.
Thank like, literally what? And besides, like, I came into watching football.
You lived in every state. You could have been a team. You could have been a fan of, like, half the league.
You could be a Cardinals fan right now.
And I didn't spend as much time in nearly any of those places as I did New England or Texas, but it was South Texas. So, I guess, like, maybe the Spurs is, like, the only team that I could have picked up on.
I pegged you as a Spurs fan when I met you. I thought you were a Spurs fan.
But I was born,
you look like a Spurs fan.
But I was born at
Riverwalk, for sure.
I was born in Oklahoma, so I prefer Oklahoma teams. If Oklahoma had an NFL team, I would get one. I actually kind of fuck with the – I sort of kind of used to before I started despising them, like the Houston Texans, because they used to be the Tulsa Oilers back in the Diz.
The Houston Oilers.
The Tulsa Oilers.
Oh, shit. Wait a minute. When?
Back before our grandparents were born.
God damn, that is – my grandma's 83. That is a long time. That is not knowledge I have. So
the Tulsa Oilers moved to Houston and became the Houston Oilers, and then they changed.
Preach.
So, yeah, shout out to the Texans, who used to be something different.
Damn, I wouldn't be a Titans fan either, though. I don't blame you. They're fucking awful.
Yeah, I mean, no one in Oklahoma is a Titans fan anyway. Like, that's too far.
No one should be.
That, geographically speaking, it's too many. It's too far on the plane.
And y'all got your own set of barbecue anyway.
What, Tennessee?
No, like Oklahoma.
We kind of just, it's like Texas.
JR's barbecue.
Anyway.
I'm regretting this hoodie now.
I'm like, yeah, I'm getting a little hot.
It's been hot. It's, and I'm closest to the fan.
I'm burning the fuck up.
Well, if you guys stop fucking talking and get through the show.
All right, moving on. Take our tangents. Kevin Porter Jr. was charged with literally destroying his girlfriend's face so bad that it broke her neck. And then pled not guilty.
Good, I don't even know where Kevin Porter is in
the
league.
He literally just got an $80 million contract and then does what?
Yeah, fuck him. He can eat a sledgehammer. He can eat a brick to the face.
How do you hurt someone so bad in the face that you crack one of their vertebrae?
You keep hitting them until they can't defend themselves.
But pleading not guilty is crazy because, like, if you
plead, he did it.
If, like, you plead guilty or no contest, like, you're getting what? A couple years max?
Oh, no. He's getting... He's getting worse than that.
He gets like a year, two tops.
Getting out of the paint.
What state was it in?
I have no idea.
I think they're in Texas.
Yeah, and they're lenient on wife beating and shit over there. So you
and
would get,
divorce and shit.
You would get like a year, maybe 18 months, 2 years.
She was a former former WNBA player, and she had like a really big deal, a really big marketing deal coming out at one point.
But for real, you plead no guilty no contest, right?
No, he's going to trade him.
You put your tail between your legs.
Yeah,
say,
NBA Twitter was nasty for that. They said
you get 18 months. But no, now he's taking it to trial, and now he's going to get 5 to 10.
But, I mean, Miles Bridges kind of got away with fucking up his girl, too.
I mean, a lot of athletes do, but it's just like this one specifically.
I feel
like
this one was worse, though.
Because there's so much proof. There's so much proof. Like,
I mean, but low-key, there was a lot in the Bridges shit, too, but his was all like a little bit more like circumstantial.
It didn't hit the internet.
Like 2 years ago.
It didn't hit the internet the way it did. And he had it in a contract year.
Yeah.
This dude just got paid. And we're talking about, he beat the fuck out of this former WNBA player.
Just an insurmountable amount of proof. Like, dude, just.
And it's disgusting. He should get.
He's going to get 5. He could have got a year. He could have got a year. Now he's going to get 5 to 10.
He should get stomped out.
I mean, I don't know.
Is not his first off-court thing.
Yeah.
Said he was suspended at USC for 2 games.
I think he fought
was
a
in a car accident. Had a gun in a car, had weed in a car.
Okay, well, but like, I wouldn't hold that against him specifically.
I mean, if you have a gun in a car in LA, that's kind of a problem.
Well, I mean, like, I wouldn't say he was inherently like a terrible person.
Failure to control a motor vehicle and possession of marijuana.
Pretty much got a
DUI, but the lesser version of it, because he's an athlete.
Yeah.
It's wild.
So good job ruining your own next
he'll probably never play again.
Years. I mean, probably not. Like I said, he could have gotten hit with a cool 18 months. Got a nice deal and a low security freaking
gin pop. Yeah, he fought the coach. He got into passive aggressiveness with his last GM.
Nah, he needs to get packed out. That's
three strikes.
I don't condone hitting
women. That's low-key how I feel about Tyreek Hill, but no one's ready to have that conversation, low-key. But
because he's an all-pro receiver now. That's why.
All right. Next one.
If he never developed, it won't care.
Oh, yeah. But, yeah, I mean, Kevin Porter's kind of was him for a little bit there, too. But all right. Moving on. Rip Kevin Porter and his poor girlfriend. Let's see. Should the Jets stick to Wilson or dabble in the available quarterback market?
Dog, that fucking clip of RG3 where he threw himself in that fucking names.
No way.
Yeah, he was like, oh, yeah, guys like Colin Kaepernick. Who else? Carson Wentz. Colin Kaepernick, Cam Newton. Colt McCoy and me. Like, I just was talking to a GM this past offseason. He was like, yeah, I see you can still play, but, you know, you'd be a distraction to our starter if we brought you in because you're just too big, high profile, blah, blah, blah. It's like, dog.
I mean, I'd rather have RG3 than Colt McCoy, not gonna lie.
Which one of the ones doesn't fit the most, though? Like, I mean, outside of Colt McCoy. Like, I don't even know if he said Colt McCoy, but still.
Colt McCoy's been in the air.
RG3 is not he's not on Cam's level. And
honestly, if anybody, you could probably
say it's Carson Wentz. Honestly, Carson Wentz probably have a pretty similar career. Had those first hot 2 years, and then
it's just fucking cold. The way the offense is built, it's not for Cam Newton. I don't think
it's really not.
Yeah, not that offense.
Rodgers, Wilson, like Carson Wentz.
I mean, if he just gets the ball out quick, that's really all you have to do, bro. Is just get the fucking ball out, and that's why I would stick with
Cam Newton. Wilson, try to be Superman, and get
Wilson can develop.
And
still,
I think Wilson's matured a lot in the past year. Like, you could see it in his demeanor. You could see it how he's handling himself. Like, he just looks a lot more ready, a lot more mature.
And so, he knows, like, I know what the pecking order is because Aaron Rodgers. I've been watching him throw all offseason.
And also, like, I mean, we saw Daniel Jones have a breakout year after everyone was ready to count him out. So I don't know. There's a chance for Wilson. He has everything around him. Like, if he doesn't succeed, it's not because there's no talent around him. It's not because he doesn't have a defense. It's not because he doesn't have a running game. So, yeah, I would stick with Wilson. If you want to bring one of those guys in as insurance so they learn the offense and maybe they step in, and if he gets hurt, then sure. But I feel like you have to stick with Wilson.
You agree, Kenny?
Totally.
Yeah. Alrighty then. Next up, we're headed back. We're talking about Jim Trotter. Ex-NFL media journalist Jim Trotter sues the league.
I recuse myself from this conversation.
Institutional discrimination. Pete, the floor is yours.
Yeah, man. I'll just say this. One of the biggest kind of issues, things that people have been harping on in the whole lawsuit is the whole DeMar Hamlin game where Jim Trotter was reporting updates that they were planning to play when they weren't going to play. And there was like this whole back and forth of if they were going to play, if they were not going to play after Hamlin, you know, essentially lost consciousness on the field, nearly died. And he reported that they were going to warm up and play again, even though they were trying to keep that under wraps. I think the thing for me that rubbed me the wrong way is that Trotter is like a real ass journalist. Like, if you look at his career, like, he's worked his way up as a traditional journalist, jumping from newspaper to SI to, you know, beat reporting to basically being a made man with the NFL Network. I think he was even at the Undefeated for a little bit. Now he's at the Athletic. Like, he's had a career path that doesn't really even exist anymore. But he's a legend, as far as I'm concerned. He was a great Raiders reporter. I miss him on the beat. He's a great columnist. I've always admired his writing. He's a great writer. But, like, to expect that man to, like, be there, see that, and not react as a reporter, not get off his ass and do some reporting, like, why would you hire that guy if you didn't want him to do that? Right? And not just that, but like the fact that he pointed out that, hey, the executive editor texted me and was like, chill. For those of you who don't know, like, the executive editor is basically the CEO of editors. He's the person who kind of communicates between the editors and the executives. He's the one who can speak to journalists, but also, like, tied into the kind of business objectives. So for that person to come in and say, hey, basically censor, kill the story, whatever you want to say, like, that's a lot. And I think as a journalist, that would make you want to even pursue it even more.
I mean, it was an unprecedented situation. I don't
definitely
know. Like, it's really hard to, like, dog on him for navigating that as he tried. Like, because that was, there's no playbook for that.
I think the thing that's unprecedented is not somebody dying. The thing that's unprecedented is somebody dying or somebody almost dying in real time with all the sort of social media and stuff that we have now. But that's the thing, is like those 15 seconds, 30 seconds, like those are the difference between you getting 100 views and getting 10,000 views.
Right.
So you don't really have that luxury of time to sit there and
make a moral decision.
Exactly. And I think ultimately he did make a moral decision, and his moral decision was to the code of ethics and journalism that he subscribed to, not to the person that cut his checks. And that to me is highly respectable. And I think he should get a fucking award from NABJ once all this shit clears up, because he is the only one in the room raising the voice, you know. And I've been in those rooms where Troy Vincent is talking his talk, you know, and saying all the things that they're trying to do. And yeah, it looks great, feels great. But, you know, Trotter's in that room too. You know, Trotter's on the sports task force. Like, so to see that sort of presence, that sort of, you know, performance, to go from that to, like, not delivering on it at all, like, I get where Trotter kind of, like, he had to make an executive decision. He had to make a business decision. All right, next one.
Let's see. Chris Jones finally ended his holdout with the Chiefs on a one-year revised contract worth $25.17 million.
I was listening to this on the radio this week, and they're like, yeah, he watched that game from a suite.
Yeah, I heard that.
And you know he probably was rooting against the Chiefs just because he probably knew it was going to give him more leverage.
Oh, yeah.
But, yeah, like, outside of that, man, like, call it whatever you want, touchdown. Like, they needed Chris Jones. They always need Chris Jones. They're not the same team without him. There's a reason he's, like, one of the last holdovers from the first Super Bowl team.
Just want to point out, not only did he come back?
Bro, we don't need to hear that the Raiders should have taken him. We know.
I wasn't even going to say that.
But yeah, the Raiders should have took him.
You didn't. I wasn't going to say that. That's kind of like archived already. What I was going to say was, this dude has arguably been more of a force for his team than Aaron Donald has. Like, if you look at the defense, it's built around him, completely him. Like, and you factor in the fact that he came back, and even, like, the money he got, what he signed on for, it's like, okay, once you take out the money from the fines, like, so you got, what, like a $2 million raise? You didn't even, like, you could have had more leverage had you held out longer. And he chose not to, and I just don't understand why he didn't hold out longer. But maybe he's like, look, I'm going to take this one-year contract. You're not going to franchise me, and this is my last year with the team. Maybe that's what he said in private, but that's just weird to me to cave that quickly on a deal, because his agents are going to get a bulk of that, a good chunk of that money. And then for what his salary was before, it's like, you would have been better off just not skipping camp or not holding out, holding in.
Okay, then, moving on. Kaepernick and company reaches out to the Jets, and they immediately shoot him down into the dust. Take her tangent.
This is pretty fucking obvious, bro.
It's been over. I don't know why. I'm tired of it now. Like, I don't want
to
hear.
Like, they said they weren't even going to hear from him. Like, they said they weren't even going to listen to him.
And he has to know that, too.
He does.
But he's just like, I mean, I get it.
It's just like holding on to the clout.
Like, no, you're proving.
I mean, he's making money from it in a way because he's selling. Isn't he selling shit? He's doing media activist shit now. So it's like.
Well, here's the thing. We don't know what were the details of that settlement. So.
We don't know much.
And the fact that he keeps saying, I'm still ready to play 7 years later. Bro, you know that there's a new crop of QBs every year. We know they're not gonna sign you. And yeah, you can keep saying you're ready, but it's like, okay.
And we've talked about
this.
Who
else are you proving it to?
Exactly. And we've talked about this. It's like, bro, even if you could play to the same level, like, do you really deserve a job over Malik Cunningham, bro? Like,
game passed you by, dog.
Do you really deserve a job over what's the Liberty QB in Tennessee?
Malik Willis,
like,
you know, I was gonna say DTR.
Yeah, exactly. DTR, like, dude.
Dobbs.
Do you deserve a job over those guys?
If anything, you should be talking to the Arizona Cardinals and be like, let me be your backup quarterback.
If anything, he should just be trying to be around the game and mentor these people and figure and teach them how to deal with all the bullshit that he fucking deals with. And maybe change it 1%. I don't know.
I mean, he's a Kappa. He has the resources and the fraternity and the people to lean back on already. So
yeah, so he should give that
he
back.
He could already be
but
doing
But he's still
that.
Kind of just on his island, his fucking...
Go coach an HBCU.
His Skywalker shit, bro. He's really on the Skywalker
he's
shit.
He's a Force ghost?
Yeah, like he's just on the Skywalker
yeah,
shit.
I,
and
I,
the
would,
ghost,
I get
like,
it, though. I would be super busy if I was him.
I'd be in the HBCU fantasy.
But even that, bro, strange. Like, you really think you deserve a job over Cam, bro? I'm working out Cam before I'm working out Kaepernick. Like, Cam's got to look really terrible for me to want to see what Kaepernick looks like. Like, even Carson Wentz. I mean, I probably wouldn't go Matt Ryan either. Like, I wouldn't go Phillip Rivers. Like, I wouldn't go that way.
Joe Flacco.
I wouldn't go Joe Flacco.
Hell no, not Joe Flacco.
But that's what I'm saying.
I
it's
wouldn't
like
go Josh
Brown. Kaepernick is closer to those guys than he is to Wentz or Cam Newton, in my opinion.
Yeah,
in both age and experience. Like, he hasn't played in a while.
Yeah.
And it's a grind, bro. Like even I think that's the part about preseason too, is like these guys aren't hitting like they were in the 70s and 80s. They're not hitting two times a day for 2 weeks and for 2 months leading into the season. Like, and so it's like you see it with these soft tissue injuries. Like,
also if he gets injured, I think they just cut him with designation. And then that'll be the end of it.
But I'm just saying, like, you can't... There's nothing you can really do to condition your body to take a punishment other than taking a punishment.
Yeah, for football. Like you just have to get
you have
fucked
to
up.
Do it. You have to get fucked up. Like, there's no other way you can prepare your body other than that.
And your body can only take getting fucked up for so long.
Exactly. All right, two more. We're almost there.
All right, we did touch on this already.
So you can skip it then. Skip it. Fuck it.
Okay. Rip Collins. Closing out, we have Jason Peters signing with the Seahawks.
Still play. You can still play. Plus, both their starting tackles are injured. Charles Cross and Abraham Lucas, who went on IR.
Dog, the Seahawks have been having offensive line problems for, like, eons.
It went from, like, being their internal linemen being hurt to now both their tackles are hurt. It's weird. It's just like a cloud over the Seahawks ever since they didn't re-sign Steve Hutchinson.
And they didn't even face like an epic Rams pass rush outside of Aaron Donald.
That's the weird part.
Like, Aaron Donald literally single-handedly just tore them up. Like a 31-year-old Aaron Donald. Like, not 26-year-old Aaron Donald.
Is he more of a DN than a D-tackle at this point?
Well, in their scheme, yeah. I mean, he's kind of always has been in that scheme. But, yeah.
Which is kind of crazy if you think about it.
I mean, teams are, they don't really run, like, core base 4-3 principles as much anymore. Like, even when they're running 4-3s, they're still doing a lot of zone blitzes and, like, different two-gapping and things that are kind of adjacent to 3-4. It's just they're over or under one way so that they have one person on the line. It looks like a 4-man front. But yeah, there's not as many teams just running straight up 4-3 cover 2. all day long. And I think that's just because of the speed of the tight ends and the strength of the slot receivers now. Yeah. Talent in the slot. And a lot of fucking linebackers are trash. Linebackers are a really hard position to play in today's football. Because
you're either a great tackle.
You're either a converted safety or like a pass rushing
defensive end.
Semi run stuffing, a big guy. You're either like a big pass rushing guy or you're a fucking converted safety.
Athlete.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you run a 4-4, but you
fucking but you're really a tight end or a receiver.
You run a 4-4 wing 220 trying to play fucking strong side linebacker.
But you look like a fucking linebacker, but you can't fucking feel for shit for or take on a block.
For shit. You couldn't feel on a broken toilet.
Fuck. I still fucking hear that, bro, because my head coach was Andy's head coach, bro. So he was a linebacker. Yeah, so he was a linebacker coach, man. This dude would just fucking yell at the linebackers. Like, that shit was crazy. I'll never forget that.
Boo! Boo! It's like, do you understand the cup?
Rally.
Here's a cup.
Cut back.
I'm like, here's a cup. Here's some water. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to fill the cup.
But yeah, shout out to my coach, bro. He's fucking... That dude had no knees and he was like 5'4". He could yell his fucking ass off.
That's the worst.
His knees didn't even bend, bro. Like bro,
he was actually probably a decent football player too.
I don't know, man.
Had no fucking, just no fucking joints left.
That's Andy's guy, though. That's the one who
they're not doing.
Put him on.
They're not doing too great this year.
I know. I told you.
They ran into us.
I had to go out there. I had to go out there this year.
Hey Taylor,
this might be the last dance.
That's fucked up. Why do you have to say it like that? They won 10
you know
games.
It's true,
they
bro.
Won 10 games last year.
Oh, man.
Now boys want to have all these highest expectations. Like, bro, relax.
I mean, the conference is caught up, for sure.
The conference is caught up. They should have been in the Pac-12. It's fucked up.
Yeah. Well, and over that one.
I'm tired of hearing about the whole academic excuse. Cause like,
and the money. It's not just the academic, it's the money.
I don't care about that either.
I
can sell you Boise State versus Washington.
But Washington has like a fucking three times, four times, five times the endowment.
That doesn't stop Boise State from winning 10 games in the season.
Yeah, but it's different.
That's easier to sell.
It's all revenue sharing, though.
Hey, man.
It's like...
They've been revenue sharing with bum-ass... schools in the conference.
Bro, but all those teams, all the Pac-12 teams have like
loaded.
Over a $500 million endowment.
I understand that.
Like the highest one in the Mountain West is like $300
Arizona
million.
Lost to Mississippi State.
Anyways, All right, fair or fade. Since calls out the Giants for keeping Daniel Jones in the game. Quote, I don't think Daniel Jones should have been in that game in the fourth quarter. Thought they should have protected him and pulled him out. And barring injury, their season would have been over without Daniel Jones. End quote.
That's
fair or fade.
That's multiple shots taken. He talking straight to Saquon Barkley. That's fucked up. Like, fam, they play. I think they didn't play together, but I think he came in right after Saquon.
They might have played together. I think they had 1 year of overlap.
Potentially. I don't think Michael Parsons was a freshman on that Rose Bowl team.
I think that would have been his timeline.
It might have been like the next year. Because I don't think Michael Parsons ever redshirted at Penn State. He came on just like balling.
Yeah, man. I think the other thing that makes it kind of like fair is that usually it's the other way around. Usually it's the quarterbacks calling out the pass rushers or calling out calls that they should have got where they should have got roughing the passer. And it's like it's Parsons, one of the sack leaders, one of the future present faces of the league, saying like, nah, you guys are worried about what we're doing, but you should really be worried about what the institutions and the fucking leadership is doing. Because guess what? We're just playing a game, doing our job. They're the ones that don't really care about player safety or protecting their season. They're the ones that are making the risk. We're just going out there doing what we do. And I think that's what makes it interesting to me. And the fact that it's a rivalry game, I mean, I think that's a whole other element. Because it's like, and I feel like that's why Parsons has gotten a tremendous amount of respect in spite of him. Like, he could just be like this phenom, asshole, like untouchable dude. But, like, he gives a lot of respect to a lot of players, and I feel like that's why a lot of players respect him. Because he's even saying, like, he's, to me, he's also saying, like, bro, I don't want to see you guys again without Daniel Jones. If this is what you look like with Daniel Jones. Like, because we're going to play again, and I don't want to see you guys without that. Like,
competitive. I want
it to be a game.
Yeah.
Because I don't want to trot out there if it's going to be some bullshit, too. So I think it's fair. I think it's beyond fair. And honestly, it's probably a fade to the league because that's one of your faces of the franchise.
Yeah.
So they just missed each other?
Yeah.
Interesting. All right.
And he's faster than Saquon. That's the crazy part.
NFLPA director pressures NFL for grass fields across all stadiums following Rodgers' injury. I think the NFL also went on record kind of defending it, saying there are some players that prefer turf. So, I guess
they base that off the numbers.
So, fair or fade, I guess.
They base it off the numbers of players who don't get hurt on turf. Compared to the ones
that he was quoted saying
some there are players who don't care.
He was quoted saying there are players that prefer turf over grass. And I forgot who called him out. It might have been Parsons. Somebody called him out.
David Bakhtiari.
There you go. David Bakhtiari. Yeah, he was like, okay, bro. Who?
He said, name those people.
Name your sources, bro. Sources. I mean, I think it's fair for the NFLPA to pressure the NFL to do it. Like, what else are you going to fucking do? And the truth is, like, I mean, I get why the high schools are doing it because, like, it's less money to water it. It's less money to change the sod every year. Like, it's less operating costs. Like, I get it.
Yeah.
But, like, at that level, that shit doesn't matter. What matters is the competition. What matters is keeping your players safe. And, again, that goes back to what we were talking about before. It's like you say you care about player safety, but then you're doing another thing entirely. So, I mean, and people who say, like, oh, fields don't matter, fields have always mattered.
They do.
Going back to L. Davis not cutting the grass before playing the Steelers.
Notre Dame doing that.
Because he knew they were faster.
Yeah, Notre Dame not cutting the grass against USC.
Yeah, it's that's always been a thing.
Still got clapped.
That's why they play the game. That's why they play the game in any and every element. Like,
and if you
except
can play,
for Thunder. Except for Thunder and Lightning.
Like, hey, yo, chill. you can't juke Thunder. Sorry. You can't juke Lightning.
All right, and the last one. Amon-Ra St. Brown, OC, SoCal great, Detroit Lion. They said he was warned for his hip thrust celebrations. He said he almost got a penalty. Fair or fade?
That's stupid. It wasn't even that bad.
He's just going like, I mean, he's humping the air. Like, he's humping the air. He's doggy style in air.
I wouldn't say doggy style. That's wild.
He grabbed air
hips.
He
wasn't back shotting the air.
No, he grabbed air hips. The one of the clips I saw, he was grabbing air hips.
And he was close. He was on the line. He was on the line. But he wasn't throwing back shots. Like, that's wild.
I mean, he wasn't, like, fully into it, like, rocking and shit. But, like,
yeah,
he was grabbing air hips.
He wasn't
bro.
Doing what Adam Cole was
like,
doing.
Like, he was grabbing air hips. Like, you could have put a Let of the Plug AI thing in front of him. Oh. And it would have looked fitty.
I'm going to just turn over and go to sleep. Y'all can turn, cut the shit
Yo,
off.
Yo, I'm sure there's someone over
cut
there the that off. Made that fucking edit, bro.
Cut the light off when you walk out.
The plug
the
edit with fucking Amon-Ra.
Kill that fucking water bug, whatever it was.
That's going to make our account go viral right now. I'm about to go make that shit on Canva.
Do it, I'll share it.
He said, do it, I'll share it. Talking that shit, but I'll share it.
Evil twin.
But yeah, man, I mean, I think it's not fair considering, like,
men celebrations are a thing. And it's not like he, and it's not like he did the Damar Hamlin, like.
Wait, what? What's the Damar Hamlin?
You haven't seen those memes?
Oh God, those are Damar Hamlin. Y'all are fucked up.
Yeah, but it's—I mean, it's really a glitch. But it's like they added the Damar Hamlin.
And it's just like a guy,
and he's just like he goes in the end zone, he just falls limp.
That's not funny. That's fucked up.
I'm pretty sure I've shared these with you.
You haven't, because I would have seen it. I would have said something. I would have said something like, "Yo, what the fuck? Where'd you get this? What
nice dog?" Those memes have been circling for like a solid month. I'm pretty sure you've seen them.
I have not.
If you follow any of the NFL meme pages.
Yeah, they've been sharing them.
How did I not see it?
I'm pretty sure you probably saw it and didn't really like resonate.
Didn't register.
Or you were half asleep or some shit. Just went about your day.
That's pretty fucked up.
Or you were at work and you didn't want to get in trouble for laughing.
I don't know what to say.
All right, let's just jump to the rants.
I got to do some investigations.
You want to go first, Nikki?
Sure. You know what? You know what really grinds my gears? This week, I feel like Mac Jones got a lot of hate for no reason. It's kind of pissing me off. We lose the game, and then the first thing I see all over the internet is people talking shit about Mac Jones. And for what? Like, clearly you didn't watch the game. Clearly you didn't watch his performance. Y'all just like to hate Mac Jones for no reason. Everybody and their mom, oh my God, he's so mid. He's so mid. He's so ass. He throws one interception in the beginning of the game off of a hip. Oh my God. Oh my God. And then he throws three touchdowns over 300 yards and then just crickets. But then Brock Purdy turns around, two touchdowns, 206 yards. Everybody's like, oh, my sweet summer child. Oh, my sweet baby, beautiful boy. Look at him go. Oh my goodness. And the whole time I'm just sitting here throwing up like, bro. I'm right, though. I'm so wrong.
She's not wrong.
So, you know what? Whatever. If y'all don't want to give him the fucking props he deserves, it's fine, because he's just going to keep simmering in the background and doing his thing. And I'm proud of him, because he's been very over-scrutinized. I think Patriots fans are very spoiled. They're very, they have very short tempers. They call for the benching or the firing.
Sounds like Celtics fans.
I mean, thing like,
what's the common denominator here?
It's excellence. When you're used to winning so often, you don't all of a sudden, and you can't handle it. Like, you short circuit, and it's embarrassing, to be honest. Especially younger Pats fans. I know I'm a younger one as well, but.
I feel like it's also kind of like the toxic Boston sports radio culture. So I feel like even the Celtics, they kind of like hang out to dry. And it's like, bro, you just went to the Eastern Conference Finals and almost beat one of the greatest teams ever.
But the Celtics again.
And you've been in the Eastern Conference Finals every fucking year. But they still catch a lot of heat and bullshit.
Yeah. No, I agree. Like, and sometimes, sorry, go ahead. Sometimes I catch myself doing the same thing. Like, for the athletes that I follow and the teams that I follow, like, my partner will always make fun of me, because he always talks about how I never celebrate. I never get happy, and I never cheer, and I never, like, freak out positively. I only get pissed off. Like, I expect the excellence, and then when the excellence doesn't take place, I'm mad. And so I do it too, but, like, I don't, like, go on the internet and like actively talk shit about the people that I'm supposed to be backing. And it's just in that face of one of the most toxic fan bases in all of sports, Mac Jones has done really well. And I'm really proud to see how he's been growing in the off season. And I'm excited to see, based on his performance against the reigning NFC champs, I'm excited to see how he's blossomed into possibly a franchise quarterback this season.
Oop. All right, so on the same kind of energy, you know what really grinds my gears? Fuck, two things. One, that AM slate of games last weekend, all those shits were ass. Like, all of them were ass.
I didn't watch any of them, actually.
Like, you didn't miss shit. But the worst part of that whole experience, the part that kept grinding my gears the most, was fucking red zone, kept turning to the fucking field goal bowl between the Titans and the fucking Saints. I literally watched that fucking 16-16 game so much. I've watched Derek Carr for 9 years. I don't need to see any more Derek Carr. I went to the fucking Chargers practice and reluctantly watched him get balled out by Jameis Winston. Like, I don't need any more Derek Carr in my life. I'm good, red zone. So can I, like, get a red zone feature where I fucking cancel out certain teams? Because I don't want to see any fucking Saints football. Like, dog, it's called red zone, not field goal zone. Like, fuck. That's all.
Somebody gonna call me to the office like, hey, we heard what old boy said on your podcast. What the fuck is this issue?
No, yeah, they should listen to me and put in the feature that I just talked about. That would make everyone's lives a whole lot better.
Hey man, I just don't want to see Derek Carr play football anymore on my TV screen.
That's what I'm saying, dude.
But so check out my recap on fullpresscoverage.com for the USC Stanford game. Some gems in there. Pretty decent recap. And also, you know, starting to buy. Probably got another 2 articles coming this weekend, next week. So look out for that. I'm going to find this little fucking water bug or whatever that shit was. And I'm going to kill it because I just hate bugs. Like, just in general. Like, I was in the press box of the USC game last week and I saw a fucking spider, by the way. It's right underneath your foot. If you want to go ahead and step on that, do the world. Never mind. Fuck it. Yeah. Hey, I already went away. It's cool. It's cool.
It was under my backpack?
It was under your foot.
Where is it now?
Bottom line is, I just fucking don't like little critters, like bugs. Whatever.
I can't wait to leave all this shit here for you to put away. Like, all the times I put it away by myself. Can't fucking wait. Yeah, I'm about to just dip out like a fucking Irish goodbye as soon as this episode's over.
I know, you're an asshole.
Palmetto, that's what they're called. Palmetto bugs. They're just like cockroaches, except not. I think that's what that was.
So that's the small cockroaches. That's the one we gotta kill.
That no, it was a bigger size cockroach. And there's a little
It was like teardrop shape, right?
It looked like there was antennas.
It had like a bigger booty at the end.
It did. Yeah, those are the bad ones. Those are the bad ones.
They reproduce on their own or what?
Yeah, those are the bad ones.
Well, whatever that little shit was, I think it was probably smaller than that.
But the smaller, the worst.
It was a big one, but it wasn't like
the thumb size ones. Those are the ones you don't have to worry about. Those are the German ones. Those are the ones that live in the water. Those ones are.
It looked like a German one.
They get out, they die.
Like a German one, and I'm gonna kill it.
They die in like 30 minutes.
Well, I'm gonna Bambi's mother that shit.
No, it would already be dead if it was that one.
Well, it hasn't.
Because it dies when it's out of water.
Well,
that's why they live in the sewers and the drains.
I don't know where the fuck that shit came from because I cleaned out all my shit. Whatever. I just, as a kid, like, even like spiders, like, if it was a small bug, I just killed that shit. The only thing I don't kill are ladybugs, because apparently that's bad luck.
Ladybugs are actually ridiculously huge assholes and pests and very, very bad for the environments that they infest.
Wait, hold on, what?
They're very bad bugs.
So I'm supposed to kill ladybugs?
No, don't. They're cute. It's fine.
No, what the fuck? You can't just say they're a pest to society. I'm not supposed to kill
ladybugs. They kind of are. They kind of fuck up every ecosystem they get their hands on.
That's really bad. That's worse than the palmetto, apparently.
And most of the ladybugs that you see are men. They're men bugs, not ladybugs.
Ladyboy.
They're ladyboys.
Yeah.
The ugly ones, you know, the orange ones, those are tend to be female.
Yeah, I don't fuck with orange ones, but the red ones, I just get mad when I see them. I just get mad when I see bugs in general.
I really like roly polies. All
right, Kenny.
I can't explain it.
I like roly polies. I'll let them crawl on me.
I fuck a roly poly up. But anyway.
What a roly poly.
I just hate all bugs. Like, I wanted all the bugs and the bugs like to die. I was rooting for nature.
Kenny, how's your foot?
Fuck you.
Bro said you were.
Yeah, bottom line is touchdowns and tangents. We out.
I got you. Oh, now he takes my intro or my exit. All right.
I just want to kill this fucking bug so I can sleep.
Run with it. Right out.
I just want to kill this bug so I can fucking sleep.
Right out.
It's going to annoy me.
Finish it.
Like when I see a spider, I can't fall asleep when I see a spider in the room. It weirds me out.
Finish the outro.
I don't know, bro. That shit just makes it. Just, I don't. It makes my skin crawl. Anyway, it's Touchdowns and Tangents. Kenneth Berry, P. Camrio over here, Nikki in the corner, not wanting to kill a little thing under her foot, but telling me that I should totally murder ladybugs. I don't know how to feel about rodents and like nature now. Thursday night, tap in with us.